privacy preserving machine learning tutorial. And now we will go to the second part, which is about differential privacy, a formal way to protect against these privacy attacks that we have seen so far, and also ones that haven't even been invented yet. So to describe differential privacy formally, let me just quickly do a probability review, like a 3-minute review, so that everyone is on the same page and we have the same notation. Okay, so let's say I toss a coin, right? Then a fair coin would be head half of the time and tail half of the time. So I would say that it's head with probability 0.5, tail with probability 0.5. And throughout the talk, we write it like this, where the x-axis is the outcome, the y-axis are the probability masses. So this is the graph representing the probability mass function. And we will also abbreviate with probability by w dot p dot as usual. If we let this be a random variable x, we will say that the probability x equals to head is 0.5 and probability x equals to tail is 0.5. And the support of the random variable x is the value that it can take. In this case, it's just head and tail. Okay, and the probability mass, of course, the total probability mass is always 1. If the random variable x is a value, then we can also take its expectation. The expectation is just the weighted average, where the weights are based on the probability mass. So if it's the random variable is the dice roll, then the weighted average here would be something like 3.5. Okay, and if I change the probability distribution, then the weighted average will change as well. And also recall that the variance represent how far away the random variable fluctuates from the expectation. So it can be defined as expectation of x squared minus expectation of x, the whole thing squared. And the standard deviation is just the square root of the variance. Right? So this is a 2-minute probability review for everyone. Are there any questions, or is everyone ready for differential privacy? Okay, everyone's ready. Okay, great, fantastic. Okay, let me. Oh yeah, just one last thing. Just recall that an event. You can think of an event as just a subset of the support, and the probability of the event is just the sum of the probability of every atom in the support. Right, and even that x is odd, I would take the probability that is 1, 3, and 5 and sum them up. Okay, that's the probability of an event. All right, so now we are ready for differential privacy. So before we do the definition, let's recall again what do we want. So as I said earlier, our algorithm will be randomized, okay? And differential privacy is a property of the algorithm, okay? It's not the probability of the data set, and it's not the probability of the output alone. It's the probability of the algorithm itself. And what is the probability? So at a high level, the property is that if we run the algorithm on 2 data sets that differ on a single user, then the output distribution, the distribution of the output must be very close. Okay, we are gonna see in a moment what very close mean. Okay, and as I said earlier, this is nice because it protects against all this attack. We are gonna see this later on in the tutorial. Okay, so I'm just copying the intuition from the previous slide. Adding or removing a single user shouldn't change the output distribution too much. Okay. Now here is the formal definition of what it means by doesn't change it too much. So here we take a look at two neighboring data set X and X prime. And by neighboring, you can think of it as differing by a single user. Okay, so X doesn't contain one user and X prime contain that user, otherwise they are the same. And you take a look at any event S, then the probability of that event happening on the output MX is at most e to the epsilon of the same probability of the same event, but when you run the algorithm on X prime plus delta. Okay? So M here denote the algorithm, and MX denote the output. Okay, so we are saying that MX and MX prime has a very similar distribution. How similar? How to define similar? This is how we define similar. So the probability of any event on MX is at most e to the epsilon times the probability of the same event on MX prime plus delta. Okay, and we're gonna see some example in a moment. But notice here that if these epsilon and delta are parameters, right? Now, if I set them to be very small, then my algorithm is very private. Let's say I set epsilon and delta to be both zero. Then what happens? Yes, the output distribution has to be exactly the same. Okay, so my algorithm cannot even look at the input at all. It just have to output something that is completely unrelated to the input, right? So that's very private. But of course, you will have very low utility if you cannot use the input to do anything. On the opposite end, if I select epsilon and delta to be very large, then this guarantee will not mean anything at all. Let's say if I set epsilon to infinity or delta to 1, then this guarantee is always whole, regardless of what the algorithm is. Okay. So in other words, if I set epsilon delta to be very large, my privacy protection decreases. But of course, it's going to be easier to come up with an algorithm and to get the utility out of the algorithm. So in practice, people typically think of epsilon as a small constant. So you can think of it as 0.1 or 0.5 or 1. And delta here is kind of a probability of failure of probability of privacy, sorry. And we want to set it to be very small. So typically, less than 10 to the minus 7 or negligible in the number of user, typically less than, say, 0.1 over the number of user. I will not go into too much of the specific, but here is the kind of bottom line here. If your algorithm just with probability delta output the entire data set, okay? This algorithm satisfies epsilon delta DP, the algorithm that I just said. And that is why we want to set delta to be very small. Okay, if delta is large, like 0.5, then the algorithm that output the entire data set with probability 0.5 would satisfy this notion. And of course, that's a bad thing. So we want delta to be very small. You can think of delta as the probability where privacy guarantee is completely out of the window. Okay, and when delta is zero, I will abbreviate epsilon zero dp as just epsilon dp. So people call this case PLDP, and when delta is greater than zero, they call it approximate differential privacy or approximate dp. Yes, PLDP will be easier to talk about, and we will talk about both in this talk. Okay, there is one word here that I sort of gloss over when we do this definition, which is neighboring, right? When I said the definition, I said that X and X prime differs by a single user, meaning you add or remove a single user from X to go to X prime. But that is only one way to define neighboring. You can define it any other way you want, but the privacy protection will change. And In this talk, I will sometimes use this equivalent notion as an abbreviation for x and x prime being neighbors. Okay, so there are two neighboring notions that people think about a lot. The one that we already said is sometimes called the add-remove DP. So because you go from x to x prime by adding or removing a single user. Another one that, and this is this is one example, right? So if you have data set X, which is this table, you remove one row or add one row, then you get to another data set that is a neighbor under add remove notion. Another neighboring notion that people also use a lot is the so-called substitution DP. So as its name suggests, now instead of adding or removing a user, you change the user data instead. Right. For example, you can start with this data set X, and then you change one row arbitrarily, and then now you get X prime. Okay, this is called substitution DP because you are substituting a row. Okay, so there are different properties of these different neighboring notion. As I said earlier, they give you different privacy protection. Add remove DP can protect you against membership inference, whereas and in particular it cannot even reveal the size of the data set because X and X prime has different size, but you have to keep the output distribution roughly the same. Okay, so you cannot even reveal exactly the output the input size, and this sometimes makes things a little bit harder to analyze. On the other hand, substitution DP, it does not protect against membership inference because you are changing the user data, but you are not adding or removing the user from the dataset. While at the same time, it allow you to reveal the raw size of the dataset, and this raw size of the dataset can make things easier for us to talk about. And because of that reason, in this tutorial, I'll be focusing mostly on substitution DP, but most of the things that that we'll be talking about also applies to add remove DP as well. Okay, so before I go into more like mathematical details and some example of algorithm, let me say that while this technical definition seems very formal and hard to grasp, it has been used quite a lot already in practice. And perhaps one of the biggest deployment is the U.S. Census. So U.S. Census is in Thai is Samano Krua. So in the U.S. Census survey for 2020, they use this differential privacy to publish the census data. And of course, the reason that they do this is because the census data contains sensitive information. For example, they have the income information for certain city block or city, and sometimes you can do reconstruction attack there. And this is the reason that they use this. So maybe the Taiwan will use this at some point, hopefully. Okay, and in terms of industry, this has been used for quite a while. To the best of my knowledge, the first deployment in industry was in Google Chrome for statistics collection back almost a decade ago with an algorithm called Rapport. So these two deployments are mostly aggregated statistics kind of deployment. But in machine learning, there are also a lot of deployment as well. This is a screenshot I take from just last month. Apple announced that they use differential privacy to train their photos model. Similarly in Google, there are many examples here. One of the most well-known one is perhaps the Gboard, the Android keyboard. That one is also trained using differential privacy and also federated learning. Okay, so with those applications in mind, for the rest of the talk, we will mostly be interested in the theory and try to understand the basic of differential privacy and how to build some basic machine learning algorithms. Okay, so let's come back to this definition again. So this definition, maybe it looks a little bit hard to to understand. So let me try to reformulate it a little bit so that it's easier to understand. But this reformulation that I will tell you will only apply to the PL differential privacy case. But nevertheless, it will give us some intuition. Okay, so let me define the privacy loss of the output for a moment. So for an algorithm M and X the input X and X prime, the privacy loss is the log of the ratio of the probability that you output this output O if your input is X versus if your input is X prime. Okay, so you take the ratio that you output output O in the two cases and take the log. And the PODP condition is actually much easier than the one that I told you in the previous slide. The entire condition is this. If you take X and X prime that are neighbor, the privacy loss with respect to any output O should be at most epsilon. Okay. In other words, since we are taking a log here, this is equivalent to saying that the ratio of the probability at any point of the output changed by at most e to the epsilon multiplicatively. Okay, so let's say if I run my algorithm on X and X prime, and this is the output probability distribution, then if there is some output here that the ratio is large, then I can say that it's not DP. For example, here the ratio is larger than, let's say, e to the 0.5, then this is violating this condition. So this is not 0.5 DP. Okay. Whereas if I run my algorithm on two neighboring inputs, and the output distribution looks kind of similar in the sense that the ratio are bounded everywhere by at most e to the 0.5, then in this case, my algorithm is 0.5 DP. Okay, so this is very simple, much simpler looking condition than the one that we said in the previous slide. And of course, this only works for PODP, but for approximate DP, you can think of it as if this condition holds with probability delta. Okay, it's not that's not very formal, but I'm not gonna state it formally. But you can have that mental picture if that helps make it easier. Okay, are these definitions and conditions clear so far? Yes. Yes. So here, X and X prime are the input data sets. M is the algorithm. Sometimes I'm gonna call it a mechanism as well. In differential privacy, they use algorithm and mechanism interchangeably. The O, which is in the next slide, is a possible value that could be an output. Okay, this is a possible output value. So M is a mechanism, X prime a data set, O is the possible output value. What about which? Oh, S is the event. So in this definition, we need this condition to hold for any event S. And if you recall from the quick review, event is just a subset of the possible output. So S, you can think of it as subset of possible output as well.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, additional question? One more question.
I wonder, you say that M is epsilon DP when it use the 0.5. Do you have any reason why you choose this number?
No. That 0.5 is just an example. So in general, if you take a look at the probability distribution of the output, then it would be epsilon DP if the ratio is at most e to the epsilon at every output. Yeah, so I was just using epsilon equals 0.5 as an example here. But that condition is for any epsilon.
Mm-hmm. So if I want to use this, I can choose any number, right?
Yes, yes, yes. So the definition is defined for every epsilon and also every delta. But as I said earlier, you would want to set your epsilon to be pretty small to provide a good privacy protection. If epsilon is too large, then the privacy protection is not good.
Oh, okay. Thank you so much.
Any additional questions about the definition before we go forward?
So actually, I have one quick question. Yes. So this pure DP condition, is it only for add remove neighboring definition?
No. So this is actually for any neighboring notion. So you want this to hold for all x and x prime that are neighbor. Yeah. But this is for any neighboring notion, not just for add remove. Yes, yes, yes. So this is a good question. So the question is why do we do e to the epsilon and not just, you know, use the e to the epsilon itself? I don't have a very good answer, but as you see in a moment, like some like composition theorem and so on, it's kind of easier to state in terms of the epsilon instead of in terms of e to the epsilon. But yeah, I don't have a very good answer. Yeah. Okay, all right. If there is no more question, then we will continue with the tutorial. And yes, so we have seen the definition. So the definition applies to any algorithm, right? So I can take any algorithm M and ask whether it is epsilon delta DP. So let me give you some example of algorithms that satisfy this epsilon or epsilon delta DP condition. And the most basic mechanism is the so-called noise addition mechanism, which we alluded to in the first part of the talk, right? So you have an algorithm, you have some input data set X, right? And we have some analysts that want to run some analysis here. And let's say the analyst want to compute some function G of the data set X. So instead of outputting GX, we are going to output gx plus some random noise, okay? And this random noise, if you select it carefully, it will be able to provide you the differential privacy guarantee. But the question here is, how do you select this noise distribution? And there are multiple things we have to think about. One thing is that if I change a single user and my output GX changed by a lot, then I have to also add a pretty large amount of noise, right? Otherwise, if I add a small amount of noise, then this is not enough to hide that the change caused by that user, okay? And also, it depends on other factors, such as the range of this function and how sensitive G is. And how sensitive G is exactly what I said earlier, how much does the function change if you change a single user. Okay, so now we will see the first type of noise that give you epsilon DP, and this is the so-called discrete Laplace noise, and this algorithm is called discrete Laplace mechanism. So we need some assumption for this mechanism. The assumption is that the range of G, like the possible output, are only integers. And recall earlier that we say that if changing a single user changes the function a lot, we have to add more noise. Okay, this notion is formalized using the following sensitivity definition. So sensitivity, which I write here as delta G, is defined as the maximum change from going from X to its neighbor X prime. Okay, so if I go from a neighbor x to a neighbor x prime, how large can my function g change? Okay, as I said earlier, if this is larger, we have to add more noise. If this is smaller, we can add smaller amount of noise. Okay, so just before I tell you the random noise and the exact mechanism, let's just do some example here. So if we have a count query, right? If we do if our function g is some select count under some condition here, then what is the sensitivity? Okay, if I change, if I change a single user, I mean, if I change a single row in my table, how large can the count change? One, yes, exactly. If I take a row and I change it, it will either get included or get removed from the count. So the change is at most one, okay? So for count query, the sensitivity is one. All right, how about if I do sum query? If I do sum of income, what is my sensitivity? Pardon? Yes, good point. So the answer I got was 150K, okay? But this is actually kind of a trick question because if I don't tell you beforehand what is the maximum income a person can have, then you wouldn't be able to bound the sensitivity at all. It could be unbounded, right? Dale could have had income of like a million or like 100 million or something like that, right? So in this case, we actually have to assume that the income is at most a certain number C, in order to ensure that the sensitivity is bounded. Okay, without this assumption, we cannot get the bound on the sensitivity. Okay, and this will be And this will be important also later on in this talk. How about average? So average, it doesn't change too much, right? If you have n, now the sensitivity becomes c over n instead of c. Okay, so those are some examples of sensitivity. So now let's come back to our random noise addition, and I will now tell you what exactly is the noise that you add to get epsilon differential privacy, okay? The noise is called the discrete Laplace distribution. This is a distribution such that the probability that you sample from distribution and gets a value I is proportional to e to the minus absolute value of I divided by a parameter b, where b is the so-called scale parameter of the discrete Laplace distribution. So in other words, the value will peak at the zero, and then it will go down by e to the minus 1 over epsilon multiplicatively as you go to the left and to the right. Okay, this is the discrete Laplace distribution. And the algorithm here is extremely simple. Okay, you just add a noise that is drawn from a discrete Laplace distribution where the scale parameter is the sensitivity divided by epsilon. Okay, and this agree with our intuition earlier, right? The larger the sensitivity, the larger the scale parameter has to be, the more the noise. And the smaller the epsilon, the more privacy we want, the larger the scale, the larger the noise as well. Okay? So more privacy, more noise, more sensitivity also, more noise. Okay? That's it, okay? This is this is one way that you can get differential privacy if you have this assumption. So just to give an example, right? So if the sensitivity of g is 1 and the true value of gx is 3, then you would just output 3 plus the discrete Laplace noise with the appropriate scale parameter. It's not too important here. I'm just using some number as an example. And as you can see here, with a pretty large probability, you output the true value. And then the probability of the output will go down as you go further and further away from the true output value. Okay, so the probability peaks at 3, right? Because 3 is the true value of the function, and then it will go down as you go further and further away. Okay, that's the mechanism. Okay, and this mechanism, under the assumption that I said earlier, that the range is integers, this mechanism is epsilon dp. Okay? So let's see a proof of this, and I promise you this is the only proof of this tutorial. Okay, so how are we gonna prove that it's epsilon dp? We're gonna use this condition, right? As we said earlier, it's epsilon dp if and only if the privacy loss at any output is at most epsilon. Okay, so we only have to show that the privacy loss at any possible output is at most epsilon, right? That's what we have to show. Okay. So let's write the privacy loss distribution down. So what is the privacy loss the privacy loss is the log of the ratio of the probability. Now, by definition, the probability that you output O is exactly exponential of minus of the difference between your true function value and the output divided by B. Okay? Now, these two are exponential, so you take log, so it just becomes the difference. Okay? So you have a difference of two terms here. The first term is the how far the output O is from the value, the true function value gx. And the second term is the first term is how far O is from the function value gx prime. The second is how far O is from the function value gx. Okay? Now gx and gx prime, x and x prime are neighbor, right? So you know that gx minus gx prime are small. So here you can assume, you can use the triangle inequality to say that that term, the difference, is at most the difference between gx and gx prime. And now gx, x and x prime are neighbor, so the difference between gx and gx prime, by definition, is at most the sensitivity, right? And since we set the scale b to be the sensitivity divided by epsilon, we have this, that this whole term is at most epsilon, okay? So this is how you prove that your algorithm is differentially private. It's not that hard, especially for PLDP. Typically, the proof is not that hard. And just to give you an illustration here, if your sensitivity is one, this could be your output distribution. And as you can see, if you look at gx and gx prime, the ratio everywhere is at most e to the epsilon. Okay, that's exactly what we just proved. Just illustrated in picture. Okay, any questions about this only proof in this talk? Okay, if there is no question, then we can continue. Okay. Okay, so I also want to talk a little bit about utility, right? We add some noise to the true output. So now our output is not really the true value of the function anymore. We noise it. So we have to be able to tell how much does the noise affect the output. And there are a few utility measures that you can use. You can use the mean square error, which is the expectation of output minus the true value square. And root mean square error is just the root of the MSE. And there is also maximum absolute error as well. So in this tutorial, we will mostly discuss the root mean square error just for simplicity. And here is the guarantee for discrete Laplace mechanism. The root mean square error of the discrete Laplace mechanism, if you think about it, you are just adding noise, right? And the noise is completely independent of the function value. So the root mean square error is just the standard deviation of this noise. And it turns out that the standard deviation of this noise is at most order of the sensitivity divided by epsilon. Okay. And note here that this sensitivity divided by epsilon is constant regardless of how large your data set is, right? The noise term that we are adding here is regardless of how large the data set is. As long as you can bound the sensitivity and as long as you fix the epsilon that you want, you're adding the same amount of noise. So if your data set is very large, as it gets larger and larger, the noise becomes smaller and smaller. And most of the time, if your data set is really, really large, it becomes even negligible, like smaller than the noise that you get from data collection, for example. Okay, so this is one of the nice thing about differential privacy. You don't have to add noise that scale with your data set while still give the same protection for individual privacy. Okay, now that is the first mechanism that we see. So I want to take a step back a little bit and make sure that we are on the same page here. That the point about the noise addition mechanism is that when you run it, you randomly sample the noise, and therefore the noise will be fresh every time you run the mechanism. And this is very important it's very important that the adversary doesn't know the random noise, right? Because if the adversary somehow get access to the random noise, then the adversary can just subtract the random noise, just subtract the noise from the output and get back the true data. Okay, so if you have some deployment, you have to make sure that you can satisfy this condition. Otherwise, this wouldn't make sense at all. Yes.
Necessary that the noise have zero means or
no, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. Yeah, you can add noise that do not have zero mean as well.
Okay.
And in fact, people also use truncated and shifted Laplace distribution quite a lot, so okay. That the noise is always positive.
Because you mentioned that the attacker can query this multiple times and it still preserve the epsilon DP, right?
Okay. Okay.
But I see that if the noise is zero mean, you can it can just average out, and then you get expectation.
Yes. Yes. So this is a very good point. You can run multiple DP mechanism; it remains DP, but with worse parameter. Okay. And we're gonna get to that in a few slides. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you for the question. Okay, but the point here is that the adversary doesn't know the noise, right? That's why the adversary cannot subtract the noise from the output. Okay, that's kind of the point here. And as I also said earlier, different noise will give you different privacy guarantee and different utility guarantee. So let's now see some other noise that are also used in practice and are very important in machine learning. So first, let me start by a generalization of the discrete Laplace mechanism to the multi-dimensional case, okay? So in the multi-dimensional case, your output gx is not just a single integer anymore, it's a vector of integer of size of length d. And now we have to, now it's not super clear how to define the sensitivity, right? Because previously it was just an integer. So in this case, the notion of sensitivity that people typically use is LP sensitivity, where P is the norm that you want to that you want to measure the sensitivity in. And now you define it in the same way as before. So you take a look at GX and GX prime, and look at the difference in the LP norm. And LP norm is pretty simple, right? So in the L1 norm is just the sum of absolute value. L2 norm is just the Euclidean norm, the Euclidean distance. And for, just to give you some example before stating the mechanism, you can think about a histogram, right? Let's say we have a table. We want to compute a histogram on the income. Then we will have a histogram that looks something like this, where we have a bunch of bins on the income. And here we can represent it as a vector, right? Where the first integer here is the number of people in the first bucket, the second in the second bucket, and so on and so forth. Okay, now if I change a single row in my database, what is the sensitivity, the L1 sensitivity of the histogram? Okay, if I change a row in my database, what could happen to the histogram? I mean, 2, yes. Yeah. So if I change a row, right, some people will get moved from one bucket to another bucket, right? So in this case, each changing of a row will affect just 2 buckets, and each effect is at most 1. So the L1 sensitivity here is at most 2. Okay, so this is an example here. And it turns out that discrete Laplace generalized to the multi-dimensional case very, very easily. Okay, you just add discrete Laplace, independent discrete Laplace noise to every single entry. And instead of scaling with the sensitivity divided by epsilon, you just use the L1 sensitivity, because you are now in higher dimension, not just in one dimension. Okay, that's it. Now this algorithm give you epsilon differential privacy. Okay, so just add noise independently to each query, and change the scale, change the sensitivity term to the L1 sensitivity. Okay, and this proof, I'm not gonna go over it, but you can try to do it back home. It's pretty easy. Yeah, there are only a few changes that are highlighted here, but otherwise it's the same as in the one-dimensional case that we already did earlier. All right, so I want to talk a little bit about this this assumption that we state here. So is it necessary that we need the output G to be an integer? Yeah, it is, right? It is because we are adding a noise that is an integer. So it doesn't change anything after the decimal point. So if we were to allow Gx to be non-integer value, then we would be completely leaking the fractional part without any noise at all, right? If my Gx is 0.1 and Gx prime is 0.2, then if I add integer noise, I can tell them apart with 100% probability, right? So we have to come up with different type of noise if we want to get privacy for real value function. Okay, and this is the next part of this talk. So I have to also do a bit of a probability review again, part two. So part two is for continuous random variable, right? So in continuous random variable, instead of looking at probability mass function, you look at probability density function instead, right? And here, probability density function, we will denote it by little f, and the identity, the main identity here, in case that the random variable is one dimension, is that if you integrate the probability density function from A to B, is exactly the probability that the random variable is between A and B, something like this. And this also holds for any measurable set as well. It's not too important, but the important part is we'll use the probability density function. Okay, now privacy loss in the discrete case, we say that is the log between the ratio of the probability, right? But if the mechanism output can be continuous, it doesn't have to be discrete, then the probability doesn't make sense. I mean, they are zero. So instead, you take a look at the probability density at O instead, and take the ratio of the probability density instead of ratio of the probability mass. Okay, that's the only thing that changed. Previously, you take the ratio of the probability mass. Now you take ratio of the probability of the densities. And now you can show that, you can show again exactly the same as before, that is epsilon dp even only if the privacy loss is at most epsilon everywhere. Okay? So in other words, even if we are in the continuous distribution setting, we can still check whether an algorithm is epsilon dp by just looking at its privacy loss and check that it's at most epsilon. Okay, now let's come back to the noise addition mechanism. So we want to add noise, but now our function g can have real value. So we're gonna add a real value distribution as well, and this is the Laplace distribution that we'll use here. Laplace distribution is basically the continuous version of the discrete Laplace distribution. So the probability density peak in the middle, and it goes down exponentially as you go further away from zero. In particular, the probability density at C is exponential of minus absolute value of C divided by the scale parameter B. Okay, so basically the same formula as before, but for the continuous setting. Okay, and the continuous version of the discrete Laplace is also very simple. You just add the Laplace, instead of discrete Laplace noise, just add Laplace noise, okay, with the same scale parameter. Scale parameter is the sensitivity divided by epsilon. And you can show that this mechanism is epsilon dp. And we are not gonna go through the proof here, as I promised, but this is the illustration. You just take a look at the two probability density of to neighboring data set, and you can see that the probability density changed by no more than e to the epsilon multiplicatively. Okay, so it's not hard to prove. You can try to do it at home. Root mean square error is roughly the same as well. It's order of sensitivity divided by epsilon. Again, constant noise regardless of the size of the data set. Yes. Yeah, you can add. I guess Laplace is a natural distribution, and it was also the first distribution that was used. But actually, there are other distributions that have lower error, and it's called staircase distribution. I'm not going to present it today, but yeah. So the short answer is like the most natural and the first one that used, but it's not even the optimal one. But for some reason, people teach about it. It's kind of easy to handle. We are gonna go to Gaussian in a moment. Yeah. Okay. So before I go to Gaussian, let me say that multi-dimension version works the same way. Okay. Very simple. If your function is a vector value function, just add independent Laplace noise to each entry. Okay. But now your scale is like the L1 sensitivity divided by epsilon. Okay. That works. Give you epsilon dp. All right, now we come to the Gaussian mechanism. Another natural noise to add is the Gaussian noise. Okay, now Gaussian noise, you probably have seen it before, so the probability density function is proportional to exponential minus c square over sigma square, where sigma is now the standard deviation of the noise. Okay, so it looks more like this, more obtuse in the middle. And yes, so Gaussian noise also give you privacy, but it only give you approximate differential privacy. And I will not go into too much detail, but the reason is that as you go to minus infinity or infinity, the ratio of the privacy loss actually becomes arbitrarily large. So you don't get the standard PODP setting. So if you go and check the condition I told you earlier about the log, the privacy loss, it will not be bounded by epsilon, because of this very corner case that they are very far away. So it does not satisfy PODP, only satisfy approximate or epsilon delta DP. Okay? And the exact sigma that you have to use is from this formula is, again, it's not really too important, but roughly is the order of square root log 1 over delta over epsilon times the sensitivity. So it's still scale with the sensitivity and 1 over epsilon, but now you have this root log 1 over delta term as well. Okay, so this Gaussian mechanism, it kind of looks weird, right? This term, if you take a look at it, then you see that it's always larger than Laplace. So why would we even want to use this noise? So it turns out that this noise, we want to use it because in high dimension, it works very well with L2 sensitivity. So previously in Laplace or discrete Laplace noise, we need to use the L1 sensitivity, but L1 sensitivity is kind of not natural in many settings, including in many machine learning settings. But L2 sensitivity is doesn't work with discrete Laplace, but it works much better with Gaussian. Okay, in particular, if your output is now d-dimension, you can add independent Gaussian noise to each entry of your output, where now the scale, you change the scale, the sensitivity term to the L2 sensitivity term. Okay, and this will give you epsilon delta dp. Okay, so that's the Gaussian mechanism. And the proof is a little bit complicated, so I will not go over it. And perhaps the most important example, and the one that we will use later on, for this mechanism is in the case of vector summation, right? Imagine users having each having a vector, and we want to compute the gx, which is just the sum of these vectors. Now, if I tell you that each vector has L2 norm at most, say c, then what is the sensitivity? What is the L2 sensitivity of g? If we change one vector, how much can the sum change? 2C, yes, exactly. The sensitivity is at most 2C, right? The worst case is if a vector is pointing this way and you change it to point exactly in the opposite way. This will change 2C. So the L2 sensitivity here is at most 2C. So now you can add, you can apply Gaussian mechanism to this vector summation problem. And we will see this apply in the stochastic gradient descent. Okay, so before I go to how to use DP in ML application, let me just say a few words about protection against privacy attack. So recall that earlier we said that we are looking at the setting where we run our algorithm on a data set and another data set that we add a user in, and we want to compare the privacy violation score here. Right? Now, these two data sets, they are add-remove neighbors. Right? So it turns out that if you just follow the definition of DP, then you immediately get that the score in both cases, the expectation of the score in both cases are almost the same. In particular, in one case is at most e to the epsilon times the other case plus delta. So if you set epsilon and delta to be small, these two are almost the same. In other words, you are protected against this privacy violation that we quantify in this particular framework. And again, I'm not going to go over the proof, but the proof is relatively simple. You can try this at home. Yeah. Okay, so now another thing that I need to discuss before we can go and build more complicated DP mechanism are the properties of DP. Okay, so the first property of DP is that it's resilient to post-processing. What this means is that if you run your epsilon delta DP mechanism, produce some output, maybe some machine learning model and so on, and you use it in some downstream task, then you don't have to worry about it at all. This can be arbitrary task, and the output remains DP. Okay, so if you run a DP mechanism, you run anything on top of it, it remains DP. So this is called a post-processing property. Another property, which is the property that was asked about earlier, is about composition. Right? In composition, let's say you have a data set, and now you run multiple DP mechanism on it. Maybe there are multiple query, and in each query you add the appropriate noise. Then you are asking whether all these remains DP, right? And to state this theorem, it's easier to visualize it as if we are running multiple algorithms. So we can think of each query as a single algorithm, like the first query as the first algorithm, second query as second algorithm, and so on and so forth. And in this way, we'll have that each algorithm is DP, right? Algorithm one is epsilon one delta one DP, algorithm two is epsilon two delta two DP, and so on. And we want to answer, if we take the output, all these output combined, does it remain DP? So the answer is yes, it remains DP, but the parameter gets worse. And there are multiple composition theorem with different value of privacy parameter that you get at the end. Let me start with the basic composition theorem. So the basic composition say that if you run K algorithm, where the I algorithm is epsilon I delta I DP, then it remains DP where you just have to add up the epsilon and the delta. Okay, this is a very, very simple mechanism. You just add a very simple theorem. You just add up the epsilon and delta. Or in other words, if you have a fixed epsilon beforehand and you want to run K mechanism, you can just divide your epsilon by K. And think of that as a budget for each mechanism. Okay, now what does this mean? If my epsilon and my delta are all the same for each algorithm, then my epsilon bow up will be roughly k, right? Because we are adding all the epsilons up. In somewhat of a very surprising twist, at least to me, this is not the best that that you can do. So there is a so-called advanced composition theorem that says that actually epsilon has to grow by more like square root k instead of k. But you have to pay a little bit in terms of the delta. Okay, so it's not really too important for the the purpose of this tutorial, but I want to emphasize that this basic composition theorem is not the best that you can do, and there are more advanced theorem and tools to do this composition. Okay, and yeah, sorry, I skipped this slide earlier, but this is also important when we do more complicated algorithm, that this basic composition works even in the so-called adaptive setting. And by adaptive setting, we mean that the adversary gets to see the output one before deciding the query for the next algorithm. Okay, so the query for the second algorithm can depend on the first output, and the query on the third algorithm can depend on the first and second output, and so on and so forth. Okay, and a basic and composition, I want to emphasize one more thing, which is that we saw earlier that K anonymity fails with composition, right? We have seen earlier that we released two databases that are both K anonymous, but together they are not K anonymous. So this is yet another advantage of differential privacy over some other ad hoc notion of privacy. Okay, the next one it looks fairly similar to the previous one, but it's somewhat different, and it's called parallel composition. So in parallel composition, you are again running K algorithm on the data set, but you don't run each algorithm on the entire data set, okay? So let's say you partition your data set into a K part, and then you run the first algorithm on the first part, the second algorithm on the second part, and so on and so forth. Then in this case, it turned out that you don't have to add up the epsilon and delta at all. So your entire algorithm is epsilon delta DP. The epsilon delta doesn't grow with the number as long as you partition the data set. Okay? And this kind of makes sense, right? Because each user belongs to just one partition. So you know, intuitively, each user, the data of the user is run in just one algorithm. Right? Okay. Another important property is amplification by subsampling. Okay? So let's just say I take a data set, and then instead of running an algorithm on the entire data set, I subsample, I take a random sample of the data set, and we're gonna go into more detail in a moment what this means. And then I run an epsilon delta DP algorithm on it, right? Intuitively, this should make the algorithm more private, because you know the probability that a user is even in this data set is already less than one, right? So most of the time, the user is not even going to be, the user data is not even going to be used at all. Okay, and to state this formally, we need to define what it means to do this random subset selection. And it will be different for different kind of DP notion. If it's substitution DP, then the subsample here, it just simply mean that you sample random B users, B out of N users, in order to run this algorithm on. And in this case, the expression is a little bit complicated, but roughly speaking, your epsilon goes down by a factor of B over N. So if your sampling rate, if the probability that the user is going to be inside the data set is P, then your epsilon will become roughly P times epsilon. Okay, it's not exactly equal, but it's roughly P times epsilon. The same thing, similar thing also hold for add remove, but you need different procedure for subsampling because again, add remove, you don't even know the dataset size, so you can define a batch of size B. So in this case, you would sample by sampling each user independently with probability P, so like Poisson sampling. And in this case, you get the same theorem here. And amplification by subsampling is very nice, and we're gonna see it in action in a moment. Okay, this last property that I will talk about is the so-called group privacy. So the best way to describe group privacy is perhaps to think about some internet use case where each row corresponds to a username or like an email, but multiple row can correspond to an actual individual, right? Because one actual real-life individual can create multiple multiple username or emails. And then you ask, okay, in this case, this individual contributes two rows to the data set. Is the algorithm still DP for this individual? Okay. And it turns out that the answer is yes. And roughly speaking, I will not go into too much detail, but roughly speaking, if you contribute K rows to the data set, then you are still DP, but it's only for worst parameter epsilon. So epsilon goes up by a factor of roughly K. Delta goes up as well by this factor, which is if epsilon is small, it's roughly K, but if epsilon is large, it can be much larger than K. So again, you still get group privacy, but with worse parameter. Okay, so yes, I think I will not go into detail here. But one thing I want to mention is that one consequence of group privacy is the following very nice fact. If you have an algorithm that is epsilon at remove DP, is also substitution DP, but with parameter 2 times epsilon. Okay, so if you have an add remove DP algorithm that is that has very small privacy loss, very small epsilon, is also protect against substitution. Okay, so you don't have to worry too much about the different neighboring notion if you use the add remove. Okay, with all those main property in mind, we will finally move on to how to train machine learning models with differential privacy. Okay, and the setting is similar to before, right? We have some model parameter W that we want to train based on the training data. And again, the setting here is that we have a training data set that could be sensitive. We want to run our algorithm and output a model in such a way that this model satisfies differential privacy. So that it ensures that you can use it in any downstream task or share it arbitrarily while still respecting users' privacy. And for the purpose of this, the remaining of this tutorial, we assume that each user just contribute a single example, just for simplicity. If the user contribute multiple examples, you have to think about this group privacy and stuff. Yeah. Okay, and we are also using a substitution DP as well for simplicity. Okay, so perhaps the most basic and the most widely used algorithm in differentially private ML is the DPSGD algorithm. So just to quickly recall, right, in the gradient descent algorithm, there is not too much going on, right? You start with some initial parameter, you compute a gradient, you move in the opposite direction with the appropriate scaling based on the learning rate, right? That's the entire algorithm. Okay. So how are we gonna make this private? Yeah, throughout the entire talk, I just told you a single type of mechanism, right? That's the noise addition mechanism. Okay, so that's the only thing we do. So that's the only thing that we know. So we're gonna apply that. So how are we gonna add noise? We can add noise to the gradient, right? And recall that the gradient of the entire loss is equal to just the sum of the individual gradient, or the average, if the noise is the average. Now, this looks pretty similar, is it? This is just a sum of a bunch of vectors. And the I term only depends on the I training example, right? This is the sum over I of the gradient of the individual example. So each term depends on a single example, training example. So this is very similar to the vector summation case, right? Because each user now contributes a single example, which translates to a single vector, the gradient of that particular example. And you just want to take the summation of these vectors. Okay, and what did we say earlier? We say that for vector summation, we can just apply the Gaussian mechanism and get differential privacy. Okay, so I will do this. Okay, so I will take the sum of the gradient, and instead of using it directly, I will add to it some Gaussian noise, with appropriate standard deviation, and that's gonna be my algorithm. Does that work? No. You add it outside, right? So you compute the sum first before you add it. That's kind of the point, right? Because you want to add constant amount of noise, regardless of the number of users. Okay. Does anyone spot where things go wrong here? It can change the direction, right? That's fine. Let's focus about privacy before utility. Yes, it's a very good point. If you add too much noise, then you will lose utility. That is true. But privacy-wise, there is also some issue here. So let me go back here. When we add noise in the Gaussian mechanism, our noise has to scale based on the L2 sensitivity, right? But in this setting, I mean, if W is an arbitrary neural network, then you don't have a priori the bound on the sensitivity, right? So each gradient can be arbitrarily large. And if the gradient is arbitrarily large, then the noise that you add, if you add a fixed amount of noise, is not going to be enough. So what are you going to do here? Very simple. You just clip it so that the norm of each gradient is very small. Okay? If the gradient is too large, you just rescale it so that the norm is at most C, where C is your parameter. Okay, so for each gradient, I check whether the norm is large. If it's large, then I scale it so that the norm is exactly equal to C. Then the rest, I just do the same thing as before. Okay, and that's it. That's differentially private gradient descent. Now let's very quickly do the privacy analysis here, just so that we are all on the same page. So, how would we do a privacy analysis of an algorithm that looks like this? Okay, so it's easiest to think about to visualize, at least for now, as first we apply. We compute the gradient, the noisy gradient, on the data set using the starting parameter W0. And recall that this is just a Gaussian mechanism. So we know that this step is epsilon g delta g dp. Let's say for some epsilon g and delta g, depending on the exact noise and clipping norm that we add. Now in the second step, we just take the first W and do it again, right? So this is, again, just another Gaussian mechanism. So it's epsilon g delta g dp again. And we just take it and do it again and again. And what does this look like? This looks like a composition. Right? It looks exactly like the composition picture that we saw earlier. This is exactly adaptive composition. Each of these is just a single Gaussian mechanism, and they are composed together in an adaptive way. So you can apply either basic or advanced composition here and get that the entire algorithm is epsilon delta dp, where if you apply basic, you just add up the epsilon g delta g across all steps. And if you do advanced, you plug it into this more advanced formula. Okay. So that's it. We have proof that this dp gradient descent algorithm is epsilon delta dp. If we set the noise and the standard deviation correctly. Okay, that's very simple. Yes. Instead of what?
Can you give some intuition why you should add the noise to the VI instead of multiplying them?
Multiplying them wouldn't give you privacy, right? If you start off with zero, no matter how you multiply it, it remains zero, right? If you start off with something non-zero, with very high probability, you'll be non-zero. Yeah. So it's more about privacy. So if you multiply it, it wouldn't be private. Yeah. Okay, so yeah, just to quickly recap, right? Yeah, when we have like a for loop like this, instead of writing out in full, we can always think of it as if there is a composition going on in the for loop, and each inside loop is our like single mechanism, right? In this case, each code inside here is just a Gaussian mechanism, and then we apply the composition based on the for loop outside, and this is how we get our privacy, right? Just a recap of what we just saw in the previous slide, but in a more compact way. Okay, so now DP gradient descent is great, but it turns out that it doesn't perform super well. I mean, one reason is what we discussed earlier, which is that now you have to look at all the example in every single training step, and that's not great. But also, even from privacy utility trade-off, is also not great. So people instead use other algorithm like mini-batch gradient descent, where instead of using all samples, you use a subset, B out of N subset of the samples, and take just the average of the gradient of those. Okay, so let's see how we make the mini-batch gradient descent algorithm DP. So we do it exactly the same as before, right? Instead of taking all the example, we just take example in this randomly selected subset S, right? The inner loop is exactly the same as before. Just do the clipping trick to make sure that the sensitivity is bounded, and then add the Gaussian noise appropriately. Okay, so this looks great, right? But what if I tell you that you can do better in terms of privacy accounting? So what is going on here? The key thing is this line. We are randomly sampling a subset S of size B when we apply the algorithm each time, right? We are not running the Gaussian mechanism on the entire data set. We run the Gaussian mechanism only on this small subset of the data set. So what does this remind you? The amplification by subsampling, right? And this is exactly what we are gonna do here. So recall that if we were to apply the Gaussian mechanism on the entire data set, it will be, let's say, epsilon g delta g dp. But now we can visualize it as if the data set is first randomly sampled, and then we only apply this mechanism on this subsample data set. So we can apply amplification by subsampling, and this will bring our epsilon and delta down by roughly a factor of b over n. And then we do a composition on top of this, right? Now we apply advanced composition on top of this smaller epsilon and delta. So we'll get now smaller epsilon and delta. Okay? Okay, yeah, just to summarize, here we say that the Gaussian mechanism, which is this part, is epsilon g delta g dp. And because of the random subsampling, we can apply amplification by subsampling to get smaller privacy loss. And then we apply composition across the T iterations. Questions? Yeah.
Hello. Okay. So I have a question regarding a trained model. So let's say we have a data set, and we've trained it to be differentially private. If there's a new data entry or example that's coming in, can we tell if the model is already differentially private with respect to this new example, or does it need more training with respect to this new example?
Yeah, so with our framework, we will always say that it's different. It is differentially private with respect to the new example because the new example is not even in the training data set. Yeah, but that's kind of the way we look at it, right? The way the framework look at it. But if you look at different privacy notion, you might have to do something more.
So with every new example, you have to necessarily train more to be able to be differentially private, right?
No. For differential privacy, you don't have to do anything because the training example is not even used in the training. So we would consider it, the new example is not used in the training at all. So we wouldn't consider that there be any privacy leakage for this new example that just arrived.
But what if the new example has semantic information that is relevant to the privacy of the existing set?
Yeah, but this is kind of exactly the setting that we said earlier, right? If we have like some study in the 50 that have some conclusion, and we get some new data point that supports that correlation, it doesn't change anything because those study was already done before. This is kind of a similar setting where the ML training was already done before this example arrived. So we wouldn't consider it to be privacy leakage of this example.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So I have maybe some questions on the details in this slide.
Yes.
So I was about to ask because I thought that composition in your previous slide would cause degrading of privacy protection.
Yes, right? Yes, correct.
Because the epsilon and the delta will add up.
Yes,
but maybe correct. Not by a large degree if you use the advanced technique. And then you say that by random selection, you decrease, you are able to decrease it.
Yes.
By some factor. And in the end, does it completely cancel out each other or?
Yeah, this is a very good point. So there are two things we are applying here. One is amplification by subsampling, which improve privacy, or in other words, decrease the epsilon. There is composition with decreased privacy or increased epsilon. So indeed, you are absolutely correct that there are these two factors that are going into opposite direction. In general, like in practice, people just do hyperparameter tuning to get the right balance of the two. But in theory, if you do amplification by subsampling of rate p, then you can do roughly 1 over p square composition while maintaining the balance of the two.
Yeah. I see. Am I understanding correctly that you don't have too much option on tuning the amplification by subsampling because you have fixed batch size?
Yeah. So yes. So amplification by subsampling, yes, you can tune by tuning the batch size. That's the way you tune it. Yeah.
I see. Thank you.
Yeah. So basically, you can tune the batch size and the number of training step, and the batch size will give you different amplification by subsampling. The training step will give you different composition loss.
Can I have a so here I think we talked about having x and x prime. Do we actually have to generate multiple x primes, for example, x prime prime, and then do it for many cases?
Or? No. Yeah, that's a very good question. So differential privacy is a guarantee that holds for any x and x prime, but that's like more like a definition, a mental exercise that you do. In practice, you don't have to do anything. You just train on your actual training data set. But the guarantee is that if I were to give you some different data set, and if you were to run it again, then you would have output, a pretty similar output distribution.
But let's say we have a model that is not trained based on DP. So is it possible, when we check for whether or not if a model is DP, you have to check it for all
so
x primes and stuff, right?
Good point. Yeah, if you have a training algorithm that you cannot prove to be DP by hand, then it's basically impossible to check because you have to check for all x and x prime. But still you can still run like membership inference and so on to test whether it kind of makes sense. But you cannot say that it satisfies DP by just checking. Yeah.
Thank you.
Generally, is this enough that we do the like weight update with DP algorithm only in the last step?
No. So that's not enough because there might be accumulating information in the previous step that doesn't get canceled out in the last step. So if you just add noise to the last step, in general, it's not enough.
But so, would that imply that like the trained data in each step is known to the adversary too? If it's not known, then maybe applying it to the last step would be enough, and it will
produce better DP?
Yeah, it depends. At least I don't think it will formally give you DP. There are certain cases where you can add noise to the train output, which I have a couple of slides on, that you can get DP. But those are for very specific model, not for arbitrary model. For arbitrary model, I don't think it's true. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hi. This is more of a clarification, I guess. So when you add the noise, must it be new noise every time you sample?
Yes. Be new noise. Yes.
So for example, like one data point, one data entry will get different value of noise every time you do something with it.
Yes, that's correct. Yeah.
Maybe could you elaborate more about implementation wise? Because it's very easy to add noise to a fixed data set. We just add some noise to the value and we're done. But if we do it in real application, like US census or perhaps Thailand census in the future, this process has to be done in real time every time someone queries.
Oh, no. Sorry. Maybe I didn't understand the question correctly. If you want to release the data just one time, then you can just add noise to those data and just release it. And that is considered private. So you don't have to do it in real time. Like, for example, for census data, you can publish it in the same way as before. What I was referring to is the different step in the training. In the different step in the training, you need different noise. Like, otherwise, composition theorem wouldn't hold if you use shared randomness in different steps.
Okay, that's great. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, so... Yeah, I think we can continue and then maybe we can take the questions offline. Yes, so that's it, right? That's the DPSDD algorithm. It's very simple, but it turns out to be pretty effective. The only two changes are just clipping the gradient and adding the noise, right? Simple enough. But it turns out that it already performs quite well. So this is a result from the original paper that proposed this DPSGD. So here the x-axis is the epsilon and y is accuracy, and each different lines correspond to different delta. As you can see, even for epsilon reasonably small, like epsilon equals to 1, you can already get something like 95% for a pretty reasonable value of delta for MNIST. I mean, of course, it doesn't quite match the non-private training yet, but it's still pretty good. Another thing I want to point out in this graph is that when you do privacy, you typically see something like this, which is the privacy utility trade-off. As you decrease your privacy guarantee, you get higher utility, but if you increase your privacy demand, then your accuracy will go down. All right, so I want to also quickly touch upon some tricks and techniques that people used to improve upon DPSGD. So while it's very powerful, you can improve upon it in multiple ways. One way is that currently we think of DPSGD as completely starting from scratch, right? Starting from random initialization or something like that. But you don't have to do that, right? If you have some public data set, you could run some non-private training on that public data set to get some starting point, right? It could be using shared embedding, or it could be It could be just pre-training, and then you fine-tune on it. So if you have some public data, typically you can start with a better starting point, and then DPSGD will do better. Some example is you can use public text data, right, to computer embedding, and then you just do the fine-tuning on your own user-generated text. So in literature, typically people do like benchmark on CIFAR-10 dataset, and in this case, they often train the non-privately using some other dataset like ImageNet first, so that they get a pretty reasonable embedding and train DPSGD on that embedding. And this is a result on CIFAR-10 that people know. So these multiple curves are from multiple papers, but as you can see, for epsilon equals to 1, the accuracy is still in the low 70s. So it's still pretty far from the state-of-the-art result in the non-private setting, and it remains a pretty big open question to try to push this closer and closer to the non-private setting. Yeah. So if you can do that, that would be a pretty big contribution. It's a very active area. Okay, so I want to also quickly talk about other ML algorithm. Like, of course, DPSGD is very powerful, but sometimes if you have a model that are very specific, or if your loss is very specific, sometimes you can do better or faster or get better utility privacy trade-off. One interesting algorithm is output perturbation. And the algorithm is kind of exactly as it sounds. So the algorithm is you run ERM non-privately, and then you just add Gaussian noise to it. Okay, that's the entire algorithm. So you just find the W star that minimizes your empirical risk, and then you just add some Gaussian noise to the W star. Now, why didn't I tell you this algorithm easier earlier if it's this easy? Right, because it turns out that it is not private for arbitrary model, and it's only private under very specific assumption. And the assumption in particular is that the loss is strongly convex and is Lipschitz. So strong convexity is strong convexity just means that if you subtract from it some multiple of the Euclidean norm square of the parameter, it remains convex. Like while this assumption seems weird, it does come up naturally if you have a regularization term. So if your loss is convex and you regularize it, I think you already saw it on Wednesday. If you regularize using the Euclidean square norm, then it would be strongly convex. Lipschitz is again, it depends on the loss, but many of the loss are also Lipschitz. So if you have these two assumptions, it turns out that you can prove that this empirical risk minimizer itself has low sensitivity. So if I add or remove or if I change a single training example, my optimal W star, my empirical risk minimizer doesn't move that much. And this is the key, right? Now we have that it has low sensitivity. This is why we can add noise. Okay? So this is a very nice algorithm, very simple, but it requires that you know that the empirical risk minimizer has low sensitivity, which may not be true in general, but in this specific setting, it holds. Okay, and it's known, for example, in linear regressions, this type of algorithm outperform the DPSGD. Okay, another one is objective perturbation. So as its name suggests, you perturb the objective when you do ERM. Okay, so what do you do? So you pick some random vector B, and you add to the objective W dot B, where W is the parameter you are trying to find. And again, this algorithm is nice, but it's not always private. And this it requires very specific assumption. Again, one is Lipschitzness, the other is smoothness. So smoothness is basically that the gradient itself is Lipschitz. And under these two assumptions, if you set the parameter correctly, then you can show that it satisfies epsilon delta DP. Okay? Again, it's kind of nice, but you really need a very specific loss function and the model for this to be private, right? So again, linear regression would work here, but something more complicated wouldn't work. Okay, now there is another very different looking mechanism. So far, everything we have talked about is about adding noise, right? We add noise to the output, we add noise to the objective function. The latter looks a little bit weird, but it's still like some sort of adding noise. But there are all hosts of families of mechanisms as well that look completely different than this. It doesn't necessarily adding noise in any way. And I want to show you just one mechanism, but out there are many such mechanisms. And the mechanism I will show you is the so-called exponential mechanism. And the algorithm is literally just this, okay? For each W, you sample it with probability that is exponential in some constant times the loss at parameter W. Okay. Now note here that if let's say if my epsilon is infinity, then I'm gonna always pick W that minimize the loss, right? So that's good. That's what we want. And if my epsilon is zero, then I'm gonna output uniformly at random, right? Which is kind of what is expected. If you want zero DP, you can do anything. Okay, and for the middle epsilon, you are more likely to output W that has lower loss compared to the ones with higher loss. Okay, So this algorithm is actually very nice. Okay, it's epsilon dp under very weak assumption. You just have to assume that the loss has bounded range. So here I'm saying that the range is 0, 1, but if it's not 0, 1, you can just scale it. If the loss has bounded range, this algorithm is already epsilon dp. Okay, so that's great news, right? Because in the previous two slides that I told you about, output perturbation and objective perturbation, it's not nice because it's not epsilon dp for generic W. But here is epsilon dp always, as long as the loss is bounded. So what is the catch here? The catch is you have to go and sample from this distribution, right? And this distribution is pretty hard to sample. So this is a distribution on the entire parameter space where the weight is exponential in some constant time the loss, right? And this is pretty hard to sample. Okay, but the good news is that if your loss is convex, then actually this distribution is a log concave distribution. And now it's known how to sample from log concave distribution efficiently. So there are actually algorithms that can sample from this distribution efficiently if your loss L is convex. Okay, so you can still use this. It's always private, but only efficient when you have the convexity. And as I said earlier, this looks very different from noise addition, right? But you can also try it at home. It's not very hard to prove that it's differentially private. Okay, just a couple last things. It turns out that, like, so far we have talked about privacy and ML utility as if they are in the opposite direction, right? There is a privacy utility trade-off. The more privacy you want, the lower utility. But it turns out that there are also some nice property of DP that you get for free that actually helps your ML model. Okay, and the first one is perhaps the one that is more intuitive. Okay, and I'm putting theorem in quote here because it's informal. But roughly speaking, it can be shown that if your model is trained with epsilon delta DP, then the generalization gap is always small. Small meaning it's bounded by some function of epsilon. Okay, and if you think about it, it kind of makes sense, right? Like, what does DP mean? DP means that one single example doesn't change the output distribution too much. So your model should be generalizing pretty well because no particular example really influences it too much. And this can be formalized. So this is something you can get for free. Okay, this second one I'll skip since it's at time. Okay, so I want to just quickly conclude here. So today we have seen a bunch of privacy attacks that can take ML models or some aggregated statistic and from that invert it back to get the sensitive data. And then we learn about differential privacy, which is one formal way to protect against these kind of attacks. And differential property also have a very nice properties that we have seen, like composition, post-processing, and so on. And lastly, as we just saw, differential privacy can also be applied in the ML context. And as I also said earlier in the talk, these are also already used in practice, not just in research. In terms of research direction, as I said earlier, there are a lot of work trying to improve differentially private ML accuracy in general. Even CIFAR-10, there is still a lot of work going on. And there are also some other related direction about relaxing the notion of neighboring data set, right? So far in the entire talk, I only talk about add, remove, or substitution DP. But you can also think about the setting where part of the data set is considered public and you only want to protect some part. Like maybe the example itself is public, but the label is user generated, so you only want to protect against that. So there are also a lot of work there as well. There is also a lot of work about distributed model of DP. In many use cases in practice, including Gboard that I told you earlier, the training is actually done in a distributed manner because the data are on your phone, right? And we don't take all the data to a central server and train it. So actually there is an interactive distributed protocol that does this training. And for this, you need a different distributed model of DP. And there are multiple ways to formalize it, like federated learning, shuffle DP, or local DP. These are all very active and interesting area of research. And there is a privacy accounting, and privacy accounting, which is about composition, but also this question about how you track privacy loss over time, which I think is related to one of the questions. Like if you have, if your data set in real life, right, in that data set is evolving and you have to retrain your data, how do you bound the privacy loss, right? If you look at an infinite time horizon, all of us will contribute so much data that any DP guarantee will not be meaningful. So how would we formalize something that is meaningful? So this is also one area of research. And yeah, just to show you how active it is, these are some of the privacy papers from last NeurIP. So yeah, if you are interested in working on differential privacy, I would definitely recommend it. I think it's a very active area, and there are many things to be discovered. Okay, now if you want to go and implement differential privacy, fortunately you don't have to go and implement it from scratch today. There are many open source libraries, like the for generic DP library, like for data analysis, there are our Google DP library, there is IBM also has their library. There is an open DP library maintained by Howard as well. And for ML specific library, you have TensorFlow privacy, and also PyTorch also have their Opacast library as well. So these, you can go and try out DPSGD today. It's very simple, just a few lines of code. Okay. Okay, so parting thoughts. So I just want to make sure that we always think about the privacy of the user, right? All of us will go out there and do machine learning or data analysis and so on. And often we have to touch user data. And even when there is consent, I think it's good to make sure that we use data responsibly. If you can get formal guarantee like differential privacy or some other notion, it would be preferred over some other kind of ad hoc protection. But even if you cannot get DP, maybe DP is not the right guarantee for your setting, or maybe DP degrade your utility too much, it would still be nice to at least try and test against concrete attacks to make sure that the state of the art attacks cannot get your users' data. Okay, and finally, this field move very fast, so make sure as well to check the latest literature. Even stuff that I teach now are like a few years old. The new ones are more complicated already. All right, and with all that in mind, thank you very much.
I think we are over time, so we can perhaps take our questions offline. And so I think now it's lunchtime, and we have a poster session as yesterday. Yep. We'll be back at 2 p.m.